We are back on Fresh Waves. I'm your host, Bren Masson. We're speaking with Claudiu Popa about cybersecurity. So, Claudiu, kids are leaving the house. They're going to school. Mm-hmm. Parents don't have control over what they do at school. So, are we trusting our kids to go to sites that are supposed to be safe and supposed to be vetted, for lack of a better word, by the Board of Education and things like that?
I'm of the mind that kids should not have cell phones as long as possible, at least not cell phones with a data plan or cell phones that have access to even Wi-Fi. I think I would get them one of those old Nokia 6000s that are good for self-defense, but there's not much more.
Because they're heavy enough, I think your BlackBerry falls
it's
into
like
that
a
category,
brick.
Doesn't it?
That's right, but I've got, you see, it's covered in rubber, so it's kind of useless.
Right, although it can still do some damage. There's a phone for seniors that we got from my mom, and that we had to really research to find a phone for seniors, because we didn't want my mom going on to all these sites or having the phone all of a sudden tell her that she has to pay Revenue Canada, because that just is not something that we want on an 89-year-old's phone. We found one, really nice big numbers. It was easy to use, and it is just a phone.
So it's
scammers. Not a smartphone. It is a phone.
So it's a dumb phone, but scammers can still call you at dinner time and say,
oh, for sure,
you need to pay
for sure,
this
but
amount.
She only uses it when she's out. So I'm thinking for kids when they go to school, something, a phone that basic would be great, because they don't need to be texting their friends. They don't need to be going onto websites and playing games. They just simply need, if you feel that you can't let their kid out the door without having some mode of communications to contact them with, then a simple phone like that would be perfect.
I'm okay with them texting each other. I'd like them to have telephone access, but I'm not okay with them playing games on them because they don't know when to stop. It's just difficult.
Right.
Now, there's a number of apps that you can put on your phone. I think even Disney has one where you can control how much time they spend on the phone. But unfortunately, you're feeding all that information into the company. So the reason that app exists is to better understand the patterns, the usage patterns of millions and millions of kids. And I have a privacy issue with that fundamentally. As far as what kids do at school, we are counting on teachers being aware and trained enough to vet the websites that they go to. And for the most part, they go to websites that are, acceptable. They go to Google Classroom, for example, and that's a number of apps that are part of a suite that allow them to create something.
Mm-hmm.
And Google Classroom does have a unique identifier, a way to identify students in a way that is respectful to their privacy. It doesn't necessarily care what your kid's name is. It just assigns them a unique identifier that is unique to Google. Apps that don't do that are a privacy invasion. So there's any number of them, and they, unfortunately, the school board does use a number of them because they don't know how to select them. They don't have expertise within the school board to know the difference between, let's say, Google Classroom, which assigns an arbitrary unique identifier, and another tool which takes the student's Ontario education number, the OEN, the unchangeable number, plus the student's name, and uses that and passes it on to an arbitrary or a random commercial company, which in turn turns around and shares it with others. Those decisions, we're not at that level of maturity within the school board, and that's unfortunate because decisions are being made every day to adopt these tools based on the cool functionality that they offer, because they do have sleek interfaces and they look really good, but unfortunately they're just data collection tools. They're data aggregation mechanisms for companies that will go on and monetize children's information. So it's important for parents to always ask questions about all the apps that kids use at school. Exactly the way you hinted just now, you need to know not just, you know, do you use Google Classroom? Oh, okay, I'm fine then. But I need to know the exact full list of apps that are being used to track my children.
Mm-hmm. And it seems then that teachers have to be responsible, but then teachers are often mandated by the higher ups of to what they're going to use. This is what your department will use this year, and these are what mm-hmm. we're doing, and some PA day comes along and they're coached on which things to use. So it seems like the vetting of these things has got to come from the higher ups at the Board of Education then.
Who are vulnerable to being incentivized by financial and other motives put forward by commercial entities. So it's unfortunate. It comes down to how you incentivize organizations, and unfortunately some of these data-hungry corporations will go and say, well, do you have a school board, a student management system? And they'll say, yeah, we do. Well, how about we give you three times the functionality and we'll slash our price to 95% off, and you only have to pay, whatever, $500,000 for this thing as opposed to something else, but we'll give you superlative performance if only you get you host all of your student data on our servers outside the school board. Once it's out, it's out. And that's a violation of privacy. But it's also, when it's done without the permission of parents, it's also an ethical situation.
Mm-hmm.
And I think at least morally, I would expect, as a school administrator, which I'm not, I would want to let parents know that this is happening and ask for their permission. You do need to get informed consent. That means if I ask for your permission and you don't know what I'm asking, I will go to any length to make sure that you understand what it is that I'm saying to you before you agree to your child's information being shared with commercial companies and their partners in Canada, in the US, and perhaps elsewhere. So informed consent is the least that we can expect to provide as parents to the school board before being opted into various tools that that monetize children's information.
So I'm sure there's a lot of parents who will say, yeah, so what? So they know that Johnny likes Lego. Big deal.
The presentations that I've made to educators and school or school board administrators have shown screenshots of what's happening in the United States as a result of personal information data breaches that occur because some of these tools are broken into, because they are insecure, because they're not properly tested, because they're selected by people who are improperly educated. And so those screenshots show parents being victimized with text messages that come to their phones that say, I'm about to kill your child, or did you know that I can see that your child is in the library right now, or they're in music class, how is little Johnny doing?
Mm.
I know where they are. And intimidating or terrifying parents,
yeah, for
in
sure.
situations like that. Does the school board put up their hand and say, no, we made a mistake and we jeopardized your child's safety? I haven't seen it happen yet. I've seen school boards, and it's happening almost on a monthly basis, shut down their services in the U.S. Simply because they've clicked on links that are ransomware or some other system that – some other malware, malicious software that will lock up their systems as a result of not having sufficient security in place. I've seen that. But as far as apologizing to parents, I don't see much of that happening. So accountability is a problem.
That sounds like it's a huge problem.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's, well, accountability. And then with the cuts that are going on in the Board of Education right now, it seems to me like they should be spending some money in some good areas. And one of those would be to make sure that they have people in place that are getting software systems and systems into the school that make sense and that are good for the students and that are secure.
It's difficult to do that once you've made
an agreement,
terribly
and
impactful
contract.
Decisions that that last for many years, and you've already spent millions of dollars. So,
made a mistake. Sorry,
yeah.
And go on, move on and do it right
Good
now.
Good luck with that.
Yeah, never happens.
So try to preserve the trust of parents by making them believe that you do care about their privacy. anyway, it's a bit of a transitional period right now. Many school boards are going through this decision process of saying, do we continue to manage data security security in-house, and our staff is responsible for doing this, or do we take that load off of our IT people and we move it into the cloud, and we can say that we're modernizing our approach to student information management. And
but
it's
the
almost
cloud isn't secure either.
Oh, the cloud is someone else's computer.
Exactly.
So it's and there's no way around that. It's a computer that you don't control. The unfortunate thing is there's such thing as peer pressure at the school board level. So school boards might say, hey, you know what? We've got four or five peers that we know of that have jumped on the bandwagon with this business model, and why don't you do it? Oh, you're still handling your own information inside a server room? That's so antiquated. And they're not able to defend that because they don't have that kind of leadership in place. So instead, they just say, oh, what, you've moved to the cloud? And how much is that costing you? That must cost an awful lot. Oh, no, it costs us almost nothing. So instead of saying, how could that possibly cost you almost nothing? And understanding the fact that you are essentially monetizing the student data, they say, well, I too would like to save that kind of money. And they do jump on the bandwagon that way. So it is a situation where you need to have an understanding of not just the current trends, but the technology fundamentally.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, the understanding is, where are the loopholes in the law so we can take advantage of them? And how much money do you want to save in the short, in the near term?
Mm-hmm.
In the medium term, you might be looking at very expensive data breaches, at breach response activities that have to do with not just putting in proper systems, but also fighting lawsuits, liability. So it's a different kind of vision than is being shown these days, right? So when we say, well, we have vision, so we're moving to the cloud, that's not necessarily vision. That is just following a trend. Mm-hmm. A vision is to say, well, I am anticipating the risk that comes with this transformation, which is very hard to undo, by the way. It's very hard to go back.
To go back because the information's already there.
It's gone. You've shared it. It's been shared. And you've paid people to take it off your hands.
That's the irony. That's the craziest thing.
Yes. So it's an unfortunate situation. But these are things that leave tracks. So these all leave trails. These are not things that you can look at in the moment. You can look back at 1, 2, 3, 5 years and see poor decisions that were made. You can even see who made them. Because it's usually not everyone,
mm-hmm.
right? When we say it's the school board, it's not the school board. It's a small number of individuals who have taken it upon themselves to make these massively impactful decisions and create a legacy for themselves. So, so back to your question, as a parent, I think you need to control how much time kids spend on addictive tools, whether they be social media or instant messaging or mm-hmm. apps of any kind. Spend more time with them so that they can feel like you are there, you're present. What we do with kids in our seminars, in our cyber safety seminars, is we give kids these cool tips that they can then go home and teach their parents about. They love
Perfect.
Teaching parents.
Yes.
They just love to bring them into the room and say, Daddy or Mommy, let me show you something
yeah.
really cool, right? Because yeah. usually it's the other way around, but here's the kid teaching the parent. So let them do that. Encourage them to teach you stuff.
Yeah.
Empower them.
And I find, too, that a lot of people over the age of 50 come from a kind of learning where it's almost like, oh, I can't be bothered to have you fiddle around with this. Here, give it to me and let me do it. And I'll do all the safety things for you. And I say, no. Let me do it myself. If you do it, then I can't learn. But my son, who's 20, he'll stand over my shoulder and he'll say, no, now push that. Now, see that in the corner? Okay, now do that. I don't know how to use Instagram, for example, but he stood behind me and he said, no, you're looking in the wrong spot. The search is at the top, or the search is at the bottom, whereas on something else it was at the top, and I'm used to finding it at the top, but it was at the bottom. Oh, and see this little icon over here? That's your people. Well, it looks like a person, doesn't it? I didn't know what it was for. But, you know, he makes me do it myself. And then the next time I don't have to ask him because I've already had the lesson and I've done it myself. So many people now, you see them, I think that's one of the reasons why the Apple Store was so successful. People could take in their phone and say, can you just fix it for me? I just want this, this, and the other on it. But then they're completely locked into what that other person has just done on their phone, and they have no understanding of how to do it themselves the next time.
So one of the things that I do with my own kids is I allow them to infect their computers. And they certainly take those opportunities. I came downstairs one day to find a cursor moving by itself.
Uh-oh.
on the screen, just clicking on things and then getting stuck. It's they're usually pop-ups, and they didn't have access to clicking OK on the pop-up because they didn't have the permissions. But it was very amusing to show kids, hey, you know what? Remember that app that was free, that you thought was free? These things, I mean, they're not run by charities. They have to make money somehow. So think about that. And also it's neat to see the decisions that kids make after they've had the opportunity to see what an infection looks like. Because nowadays, infections don't look like they did in the 90s.
No.
When they were obvious.
Or it looked like Pac-Man was eating away at your screen.
Something's chewing up your screen, and there's that little snake and so on. Nowadays, infections are invisible unless you get really lucky. So we try to make sure that that we allow our kids to infect those computers. Obviously, we segregate the computers on their own little network. And by the way, most home routers that you can buy off the shelf will have a guest network. So you just enable the guest network, and it'll keep all their phones and their infected computers away from your home computers. So your house and its computers can have its own network, and you can, you know, connect with your printers to it and connect computers to one another and so on, and not ruin your QuickBooks or endanger any other stuff that you're doing. And they'll have a guest network that all you have to do is enable it, and it just goes to the internet. That's all it does. It's just connected to the internet. And if those computers get infected, it doesn't jump from one computer to infect all the computers in the house. So let them infect their computers. If you've all got a friend in the family or an uncle's brother's cousins, who knows how to wipe that computer and start from scratch, or protect it adequately to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
So let them play. Let them get infected. That's the best way to learn. And you need to make sure that they have this knowledge, because the next generation is going to see a tremendous amount of change. If you think the change that we've seen in the past 10 years is a lot, that's going to be as much as we see in the next 2 years.
Wow.
So there's a lot coming, and they need to be ready for it. So taking computers away from kids is not the right
idea. It's not the answer. Of course not.
No, it's the wrong thing.
They're growing up in this world, and we need to train them how to live in this world, not to ignore it and pretend that they're living in a hut somewhere. Okay, you have some interesting courses coming up pretty soon.
I do. There's a couple of cyber safety seminars that are taking place right here in Stouffville. One is our certificate program, which we traditionally do in schools, but we thought we'd centralize. And we are fortunate that the Stouffville Public Library, that our very own WSPL, is hosting us on Saturday the 23rd, I want to say. And that's for students, grades 5 to 8.
Hang on a second.
Is that right?
I'm looking at a calendar behind your head, and it says Saturday's the 21st.
Aha. So maybe it is the 21st. Great. thank you for that.
No problem at all.
So Saturday the 21st, give the WSPL, give the library a click and see the list of seminars that are coming up. Cyber safety seminars, it's right there. And if you have a student between grades 5 and 8, sign them up to that one. If you have a student between grades 1 and 4, next month we'll be doing one for those ages and those grades. And students will get to, one, see me, talk about non-scary things. Mm-hmm. We'll learn all about passwords and about understanding what your privacy means and so on. And you get your certificate. You get your cyber safety champion certificate, which enables you to tell other people cool stuff and give them tips about cyber safety in a way that is trustworthy. You're not just making stuff up. You went through the training. You will be legit. So parents, if you want your kids to know what they're doing, send them to these 1 hour seminars and and let them play with us. Let them ask us questions. It'll be fun. We'll have stickers.
Stickers. I'm going then.
Free stickers.
As long as there's a sticker, I'm going.
The other one
Do I get a crown too?
You know what? I think now you have to. I can't say no to that. I'm going to have to go and get some crowns. Mm-hmm. We do have a dollar store in town, so we're getting those crowns.
All right.
There's another fun one that we're doing on the, I want to say 23rd now, because that sounds
That's
like
Monday,
it would be Monday.
Which is a PA
that
day.
That was some quick math. So that PA day, a lot of parents will want to let their kids explore things, and the Hummingbird Hub is hosting us. And we're going to have a really cool workshop. I think it's from 10 a.m. until 3 p.m. So that's a long one. But there's a lot of fun stuff that we're going to do that day. Mm-hmm. We're going to discover the coolest, safest sites to visit. We're going to find out how we can contribute. We're going to help people around the world. We're going to discover how to contribute in many different ways, how to learn from playing, how to gamify learning, and we're going to do it all in a safe way. So that's our BYOD cyber boot camp. And BYOD means you get to bring your own tablet or your own laptop and learn on your own device rather than learn on
device.
Somebody else's.
Right. I was thinking bring your own dog.
Yeah, bring your own
doll. Bring your own dessert.
Yeah, bring your own device, and it'll all be set up on the Wi-Fi there. But when you get home, you're going to have the same icons that you worked hard for. You worked all day to put some icons. You installed some stuff. You learned some things. We'll put some shortcuts up. Parents will be able to see what was learned and what was created in the meantime, and I'm looking forward to it because it's going to be a lot of fun. We've got a ton of sponsors around town, and we're fortunate to be doing this. So that's going to be our pilot, and we're looking forward to seeing what's going to happen.
I think that sounds like a fantastic program, and I think I wish you good luck on it because I think it should be happening a lot more often. It should even have a Saturday morning one eventually that has kids and parents, and so
you know what, parents are welcome to stay. They the Hummingbird Hub does have couches, but I don't know what the limit is for loitering. Maybe they could just busy themselves cleaning dishes or something, but
helping out,
yeah, they can totally help out. We're gonna, I think we had our registration form go out, and we're trying something new. I thought it'd be fun for parents to increase their privacy awareness and to say, hey, you know what? The parent can sign up for this using their name, but don't give us the kid's name. Give us the kid's nickname. And so they can come up with a superhero name or a pseudonym of any other kind. And we'll be going through the whole workshop with the kid having that name. So if we open a new email account for them, it'll be under that name. There will be no personal information shared, and that'll sensitize kids to the fact that, hey, you know what? I've given nothing away. This is just me and my digital identity, and I can cut off this digital identity whenever I want, as opposed to giving away your real name and your real address and your real phone number, and what are you going to do if it gets compromised?
Well, so, that sounds like fun.
It's a new model, and we're trying it all out, so come out and try it out with us.
That sounds like a blast. I might just go out and play that day, because that sounds like too much fun. Mm-hmm. I just want to go and find a new digital identity.
Yes, we'll be dishing out digital identities like anything.
This has all kinds of fun connotations. Mm-hmm. Actually, you know, the digital identity thing isn't so far-fetched because when we talk with Keith Pitts on the show and we talk about cross-border shopping and things like that, that's one of the first things that he recommends is to get a Google account that has nothing to do with you, but is something that you use when you go shopping over the border.
Oh, okay.
And you get the the IP address that comes from the States as opposed to Canada, so you get better deals and things like that. And you do it all under something that doesn't then come back to haunt you after you've gone shopping in the States for the deals. And you get inundated with all these retailers who are emailing you on a constant basis. It goes to all one Gmail that's sort of, you know, whoever you are.
No transaction is ever forgotten these
days. Absolutely not.
I think I posted an article last week. You may have seen it about what happens when you buy something on a credit card and how much information credit cards share with all kinds of companies because they sell all that data. Suddenly you're getting ads from any number of of organizations. And that's on my Facebook page. But I think you clicked like on it.
I did.
You clicked like on a lot of my stuff, but...
Because I have to. I mean, otherwise you'd say, why am I coming on your show? You don't like any of my
otherwise
stuff.
Otherwise it doesn't go away. It just keeps on showing it to you unless you do something about it.
Well, you know, it's that Facebook thing. If you don't click like, you never see that person's post ever again.
That's right.
They disappear off your radar even though they're a friend of yours.
Thank you for clicking.
All right. Well, we've got to wrap it up. Like we say, every time you are on the show, we could talk for another 2 hours. But this is the end of today. And we will definitely keep having you on for as long as we can to talk about all the kinds of timely things and breaches and all the things that people get there.
Yeah, it's all fun.
Yeah, I was going to say nuts in a knot, but you're not supposed to say that. So you're peanuts in a knot. Over. So there you go. All right. Thanks for coming in, Claudio.
My pleasure.
It's been a lot of fun. And we will see you again soon. You've been listening to Fresh Waves on Whistle FM. And you can listen to Fresh Waves on the website. We podcast all of the shows at freshwaves.ca. So do go and give it a click and listen to this show again to get the information that you didn't write down quickly enough when you heard it this morning. And you'll want to hear it again. And you'll want to go slowly so you can write it all down. Next week on Fresh Waves, we have Yolanda Pettifer for our monthly decorating show, and we're going to be talking about TIFF and the movies that you're going to be seeing in the next little while and which ones are good and which ones aren't so great. So that's next week on Fresh Waves. Everybody have a terrific day. I'll do the Ellen thing and say be kind to one another because it really does make a big difference. Be kind. Have a great day. We'll see you next Wednesday on Fresh Waves.
I'm gonna take it one day at a time. I made my resolution. I've opened up my eyes. Today I'm gonna try to change the world. I'm gonna say hello to my neighbor. Gonna greet him with a smile and shake the hand of a stranger sitting tall here for a while. Gonna tell someone I love them from the bottom of my heart. Today I'm gonna try to change the world. Yeah, today I'm gonna try and change the world. Gonna take it one day at a time. I made my resolution. Opened up my eyes. Today I'm gonna try and change the world. Gonna make sure my children know right from wrong. Never turn my back on those who need someone. Always gonna try to see myself through another's eyes. Yeah, I'm gonna try to change the world. Yeah. Yeah, today I'm gonna try and change the world. I'm gonna try. And today I'm gonna try and change the world. I'm gonna take it one day at a time. Yeah, I made my resolution. I will open up my eyes. The day I'm gonna try and change the world.
Listening to Fresh Waves, a Whistle FM production. I'm your host, Brenda Masson, and our technical producer is Jason Rumball. Tune in every Wednesday at 10 a.m. for Fresh Waves here on Whistle FM, 102.9 on the FM dial and whistlefm.com anywhere in the world. Fresh Waves is available on podcast too. Just go to whistlefm.ca or freshwaves.ca. We podcast all of the Fresh Waves shows so that you can listen at your leisure. Fresh Waves. It really is